crashing over every day. God of mercy, please come rescue me. I am longing for your voice, your gentle whisper in the noise. Father, tell me everything's all.
This is my lovely wife, Amy Longoria, and we serve on the welcome team here at C3 Victory Church. We really want to thank all of y'all for joining us this morning. We really love our church, and we think that you will too. Now let's get ready to worship God together.
His kingdom come. let your heart be troubled. Just hold your head up high. Don't fear no evil. Fix your eyes on this one truth. God is madly in love with you. So take courage, hold on, be strong. Remember where our help comes from. Yeah. Go up as the walls come down. All creation, everything with breath, repeat the sound. All His children, clean hands, pure hearts, good grace, good God. His name is Jesus. Swing wide, all you heavens. Let the praise go up as the walls come down. All creation, everything with breath, we meet the sound. All His children, clean hands, pure hearts, good grace, good God. His name is Jesus. Swing wide, all you heavens. Let the praise go up as the walls come down. All creation, everything with breath, repeat the sound. All His children, clean hands, pure hearts, good grace, good God. His name is Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, our redemption, our salvation is in Your blood. Jesus, You're the light of heaven, a friend forever, Your kingdom come. Jesus, Jesus, our redemption, our salvation is in Your blood. Jesus, Jesus, You're the light of heaven, a friend forever, Your kingdom come. Oh, 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 oh. Salvation is in Your blood. Jesus, You're the light of heaven, a friend forever, Your kingdom come.
Darkness tries to roll over my bones. When sorrow comes, still the joy I own. When brokenness and pain is all I know, and I won't be shaken, and I won't be shaken. Let's sing that again. Darkness tries to roll over my bones. When sorrow comes, still the joy I own.
Standing on the rock.
firm foundation, my firm foundation.
This morning for communion, I'd like for us to look at the definition of the word communion. You know, this week I've been thinking so much about the early church in Acts. It actually, funny story, started off with a little Bible lesson that my kids were watching this week. They like to watch this church called Kids on the Move, and they love this one pastor and the way he tells Bible stories. And he just told the story of the early church so simply and so beautifully that it really struck a chord with me. And it made me think about this time that we're in right now. And what's the word communion really mean? So I looked it up, and one of the definitions of the word communion, just to commune with someone, means to interchange or share thoughts or emotions, to have intimate communication with someone. Isn't that an awesome thought when we think about communion with Father God? The communion that was restored by Jesus Christ going to the cross, by his body being broken for us, by his blood being shed for us. We were restored back to that intimate communication with God, something that was broken by sin, something we could never get back on our own. And you know, when Jesus broke the bread with his disciples that night in the upper room, and he even talked about that one of them would betray him, what an interesting thing to say over dinner while you're breaking bread and drinking wine with your disciples, to say, even one of you will betray me. But you know, that's what was in Jesus' heart, and he was sharing it with the ones that he loved. And I love that thought, that communion, the first communion, was just a sharing of meaningful thoughts. Jesus was sharing this practice with his disciples. He told them to take this and to do this in remembrance of him. If we look in the book of Acts and we look at the early church, it says this in chapter 2, verse 42. All the believers devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship and to sharing in meals, including the Lord's Supper. I like that part. They devoted themselves to sharing meals, including the Lord's Supper, and to prayer. And it goes on to say in verse 46, and this is one of my favorite verses, I have it up in my dining room, they broke bread in their homes, and they ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. You know, I think it's that attribute about the church, the coming together, the fellowship, the bearing of each other's souls in communion with one another, that made people want to be added to the church. That's what I believe struck me this week as I heard the story again. I thought, Lord, help us be a church right now that causes people to see the joy that just is overflowing out of us, even in the midst of crisis, as we come together as believers, as we share meaningful thoughts with each other, as we come into each other's home and share communion this morning even. God, thank you for the community that you put around us. Thank you for our neighbors. Thank you for the people, God, that are being added to the church today in communion. Can we pray together this morning? And I hope you have something there at your house. Whatever you have to represent the body and the blood of Jesus will work. But grab those elements this morning and let's pray over them together. Father God, we just thank you for this reminder of what you did by sending your son Jesus Christ to restore us, God, to a place of intimate communication with you. God, and not only that, you didn't leave us alone. Lord, you put people around us in life that we're meant to commune with, that we're meant to fellowship with, we're meant to do life with. God, you didn't leave us alone, and you never do. So I thank you right now that every person, as we remember Jesus Christ this morning, will ask, God, who are those people that you've put in my life? Will you show them to me? Will you give me the boldness to invite them in and to share my thoughts, share my emotions with someone else, God? We thank you, Lord, for community. And we thank you that we're all in this together. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hey there, and welcome, C3 family. We just want to say thank you so much for worshiping the Lord with us, receiving communion, having this incredible time. And I want to say a special hello to all of our guests. You kind of feel like extended family out there watching us online. Those of you that maybe you've never known about us, you've never been here in person, you've just kind of started watching online, we're so thankful for you, so excited. And make sure you visit our website for all the ways that you can continue to stay connected to the C3 family. We would love for you to continue to be a part of our online journey together. One of the things that I love about us being able to get together and worship God and draw close to Him as we get to know Him better, and as we make this goal of to become more like Jesus. And, you know, that's what we're all about, to know Jesus and to make Him known. And one of my favorite things about knowing Jesus is that it doesn't diminish our personality, but Jesus, the power of the Holy Spirit actually brightens us up. And I love how Pastor Phil says it, is he says the Holy Spirit brightens us. He doesn't make our character and our personality, He doesn't water it all down, but He makes it even more vibrant. And I love that about God. I love the fact that God wants to bring the best parts of who you were made to be and who I was made to be. He wants to bring those out of us, and he does it so well that when we have relationship with Him, He breathes inside of us. He empowers us with inner strength, with faith, with grace, with mercy, with everything we need for living a godly life. And I think this is important because right now, more than ever, the world, people that are out there that don't know Christ, they need you. They really do. They need you. They need lives. They need the best of us. They don't need the leftovers. Let me tell you, your kids, your family, they need the best of you. And I know that there's sometimes that with my family that I don't give them the best. And kind of what I've discovered in my own life is I've seen barriers that get erected in my life that hinder God's best from flowing out of me. And I've experienced that, and you probably have too, in one way or another. And so I want to talk about one of those barriers. And I believe that one of the biggest barriers that can hinder God's best from flowing out of us is the barrier of busy. The barrier of busy. And busy, to me, is one of the trickiest barriers. It's one of the most deceptives, because it always gives you a list of good ammo of why you have excuses of doing good things and being about good things and doing spiritual works and all these sort of things. And sometimes what we don't see is that being busy is actually a barrier to God bringing out the best that's inside of us. And just because we've created this incredible list, and listen, I am a list guy. I get it. I love lists. It makes you feel so productive to create a list and be able to check those things off. But just because we've checked a lot of things off doesn't actually mean that we were walking in what God wanted us to walk in that day. That just because we're busy and we have things to do doesn't mean that we were productive. And listen, don't twist this message, because I'm not trying to give you a message on do nothing. I don't believe in doing nothing. I believe that faith is actually action. It's taking and putting into action the things that God has been stirring and moving inside of our heart. So doing something is important, but not just doing anything. We want to be about the right thing. We want to be about the thing that God has called us to do. And sometimes we can't see that, we can't hear that, and we're not connected with that because there's a barrier between us, and that barrier is called busy. We always have, well, I got to get this done and this done and this done, and there's always stuff piling up, and our time is being taken up all over the place. And one of the things that I've seen happen with this, with the COVID, with the virus, is it's given us an opportunity to take a step back and examine how we were living, and maybe was the barrier of busy really active in our life? are, were we living from God's now promises, now commands, that now connection with Jesus? And we get to look at how are we really living. And so let's pray, and then we're going to get into the word together. Father, I just thank you for this word. I thank you for everybody that's listening right now. Jesus, I just pray that our hearts would be opened up to your word. What we love about you, Jesus, is that you came so that we could have life and life to the fullest. And that's your nature. That's who you are. And we thank you for that, that as we read your word, that you give us your perspective and help us see the things and reexamine some things and help us see the areas where busy has gotten in the way of the life you've called us to live. And Lord, we thank you that as we believe you, as we trust in you, as we live the way you've called us to live, that the best parts of who you've made us to be are able to come to the surface. And we thank you for that in Jesus' name. Now, the first scripture I want to start with is in Psalm 127. And as a pastor, let me just be a little bit transparent. This scripture scares the crap out of me. And this is what it says. Unless the Lord builds the house, those who build it labor in vain. Unless the Lord watches over the city, the watchman stays awake in vain. It is in vain that you rise up early and go late to rest, eating the bread of anxious toil, for he gives to his beloved sleep. And when I see that scripture, man, it puts the fear of God into me, because I look and I say, man, the church family that you're building, God, I don't want any of our labor, I don't want any of our work to be in vain. And just because it's spiritual activities and just because it's good works doesn't mean that it's what God has for us and it's what God wants us to do. So the way I would look at this is busy does not equal effective. Busy does not equal effective. Just because we got a lot of things done in a day, even if we can point to them and say they were good things, they were good things. Busy does not equal effective. And the reason why is because God looks at everything from an eternal perspective. Man, we get so caught up in the now. And listen, I'm just as guilty as anybody. I'm kind of like a task-oriented person. And recently my wife and I had a beautiful conversation. And we talked about how sometimes I will run over our children because I'm trying to get something done. And she was telling me, babe, you've got to step back and you've got to see them in the moment. And I was like, man, I didn't call her a man, she's a woman. But I said, babe, you're exactly right. And I could see that how in my own life I was doing busy things, but I wasn't necessarily doing what God wanted me to do that day. And which is more important, the list that's getting done, the good works, or the eternal seed that's being sown in the next generation, in my kids, in my wife, in my friends and family, in the church. And so when I look at this scripture, I say, God, I want you to build this house. I don't want any, I mean, it's bad enough getting up early, but if you're having to get up early and it doesn't mean anything, that is just like worst case scenario. You don't want to do that. You don't want to be the guy that's getting up at 4 a.m. and going to bed at 10 p.m. and God's saying, hey, good for you. I'm glad you can pat yourself on the back, but that's not accomplishing anything that I've called you to do. Man, that would be so frustrating. Jesus says it like this in Matthew 7, verse 21. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father. So let's highlight that. The will of my Father who is in heaven. On that day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name, cast out demons in your name, and do many mighty works in your name? And then will I, so now Jesus is saying, then I'm going to say to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of lawlessness. I think this is really interesting because now it's saying even spiritual busyness does not equal productivity in God's perspective. even now, listen, you're casting out demons. That's, you would think, well, that's, you know, taking apart the kingdom of the devil. You're prophesying. You're speaking life into people. Beautiful. I love it. You were made to do those sort of things. But I think the bigger question is, where are we doing those things from? Where are we doing? So, because sometimes I think we can use busyness as a source of legitimacy. The fact that we're busy means I'm important, that I'm needed, that I'm valuable. And I think Jesus really hit the nail on the head with two little statements in those verses. The first statement he said is the will of the Father, the will of the Father. And the second statement he said, you never knew me. See, the more that we know Jesus, the more we begin to see the will of the Father. When Jesus came, he came to reveal who God really was, the true nature of God, that he is a rewarder, that he's a good father, that he wants to care for us, that he wants to bless us. That's what all the things that Jesus revealed. He revealed the attributes of the nature of Father God to humanity. And he said, listen, the more that you get to know me, the more you're going to see in your own life what the Father's will is for you. The specific makeup, all the things that he put inside of you when he made you in your mother's womb, when he knit you together, all those things. The more we get to know Jesus, the clearer all those things become to us. And listen, it's good to cast out demons, and it's good to prophesy, and it's good to do mighty works. All those things are good things, but it's good things whenever it's coming from the standpoint and the connection of Jesus. What do you have for me? Jesus, what is the will of the Father on my life? I think it's so important for us as a church family. And when I think of you, Victory, my heart's cry for us is to not just be aware of Jesus, but to be rooted in Christ. When we say to know Jesus, I'm not talking about an awareness of who he was. Because the Pharisees had an awareness, but there was other people who knew Jesus. The disciples knew Jesus. John knew Jesus in a different way. And I'm not talking about an awareness of Jesus. I'm talking about being rooted in Christ, that I believe God wants us to be rooted in Christ, to be connected, deeply connected to his love. And from there, what begins to happen is we begin to understand and connect with the Father's will for us. So how do we live this way? How do we live this way? Let me tell you something. I can tell when I start to live from busy instead of my connection to Jesus. And here's the major tell, because I think busy has a major tell. This is the major tell. You begin to feel burdened and pressured. See, Jesus, by the power of the Holy Spirit, always leads us into things. But when you begin to feel something driving you, when you begin to feel pressure or a burden to perform, to live up to some standard, when you begin to feel that pushing you and driving and that pressure pushing you, then what that begins to speak to me is that I'm being driven by the wrong thing. Maybe I begin to be driven by, I need to be this type of pastor based on this person's opinion. Or I need to be like these other people that I see on Instagram. Or I need to be the dad the way this other guy is a dad or a father. Or I need to be a husband like that. And all of a sudden, comparison begins to get creeped in. And next thing I know, I'm doing all these different activities. And there's a barrier that's now built in my life that's keeping God's best, the way he tended to flow out of me. It's not going anywhere because I'm doing all these busy things because I'm feeling burdened and pressured. That's a big warning sign. Matthew 11, 28 says this. And this is Jesus talking. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened. Weary, stressed out. You're eating the bread of anxiety. You're having seconds and thirds. All these. And I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me. For I am gentle and humble in heart. One of the things that I notice about myself, that when I'm feeling pressured, I am not gentle and I am not humble. I am like, this is what I want to do. Get the heck out of my way. You know, get in line. And Jesus is saying, hey, listen, my yoke is easy. And when we're following, when we're carrying Jesus' yoke, Jesus' expectations on our lives, then we have the ability to walk in the same gentleness and humility that Jesus walked in. He said, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. What does this look like? Let me tell you a story that happened in my own life last week. There was an event going on, and I felt so pressured to be at that because it's the type of thing a pastor should be at. And so I was feeling this pressure, but at the same time, there was something in my heart and spirit that said, hey, you don't really need to go to that. And so I was in my garage, and I think I just finished a workout, and so I was sweating on the mat, and I was just sitting there. I was like, okay, God, what do you want? What do you want from me? What do you want from me, okay? So I'm feeling all this pressure. I'm feeling this burden to arise to someone else's expectations of me, but what do you want of me? And this is what he said to me. He said, love your neighbor. Love your neighbor. And that was a really confusing statement. You know, I get it. Love your neighbor. You know, you're told that sort of thing. But here's the problem. My neighbors were all out of town. And I said, God, I don't know how I'm going to love my neighbor when they're not there. And I know we can say, well, Pastor Sam, what he's really talking about, neighbors, and you know, the world, love the world. Well, that's a lot of people, and you could take that anywhere. But I really felt like he was saying physical neighbor. And so I was like, well, what am I going to do when they're not even in town? And I can remember it was a couple hours later that I'm kind of thinking about this. But what that word did is it built an awareness in me of opportunity. And next thing I know, I get this Facebook messenger, and one of my neighbors came back into town. I didn't know they were, I guess they were out of town, came back into town and said, hey, can we hang out a little bit? And things begin to progress, and what started with just a hangout became 3 to 4 hours of deep conversation, of deep ministry, that I had no idea things were going to go in that direction. But let me tell you, who did know was God. And God knew all the events that was going to happen, and he knew the opportunity that was going to be presented to me. And you and I were the same in this, that it takes that daily connection to Jesus of saying, Jesus, what is the Father's will for me to do today? What do you have for me today? And I believe he begins to give you impressions, dreams, desires, visions. And then what this does is this begins to build inside of us an awareness of when that opportunity comes, because God's out there and he's working tons of opportunities you and I don't even know about. He's always working good, and he's working good for your future right now, and you don't even know it, but he's moving all the puzzles, all the pieces together. But what he needs us to do is he needs us to be aware of those moments. And what can happen is busy will come in and, like a blinder, begin to cut off our vision to where we don't see those moments anymore. And all we get done at the end of the day is, God, oh my God, I got the list done, Jesus. I got the list done. And maybe Jesus is saying, hey, I had one thing for you to do and you couldn't see it. You couldn't see it. Or maybe you saw it, but you discounted it because it didn't feel as important or as spiritual as you thought it should look. And let me tell you, man, let's not get to the point where we stand before the Father and he said, you labored, but you labored in vain. You built, but it didn't last. You struggled, you got up early, stayed up late, but it was for nothing. Man, what a disappointment. What a sad moment that would be. I would rather get there and say, and him looking and say, man, you did so well. You did so well, son. You did so well, daughter. You connected. You lived with intention. You didn't allow the barrier of busy to cut you off from the best that I built inside of you that I wanted to bring out. And so this is what I want to do. I want to pray for us, because this is all, if you're like, well, how do I do this? I don't want to get caught up and busy. This is what you do. It's going to be a daily walk between you and Jesus. There is no formula that I can give you. There are some things that I can help you with. But ultimately, what it's going to come down to is our own connection with the Lord and daily connecting with Jesus, who is our source of life. And say, God, help me. Living God, help me realize. Help me be aware. Build inside me an awareness of how you want me to love others, of what your will for me is today. And I want to pray with you to help you do that. So if you would you just take a moment right where you're at, and would you just pray with me? Father, we don't want the barrier of busy anywhere in our life. And God, we all get distracted. We all get overwhelmed. And sometimes we feel like we're leading through pressure and we're leading burdened down. But Jesus, your word just said that your yoke is easy and your burden is light, and that we should come and learn from you. And Lord, that's what we want to do. And so I just pray that, God, throughout this week, we take little moments in our day and we think about, am I doing what you want me to do, Father? God, that we would have moments where we say, I don't want to be driven by busy. I don't want to be ruled by busy, but I want to be led by the Holy Spirit. I want to be led by that source of life. In Jesus' name, amen. One of the greatest connections that you will ever make in your life is being connected to Jesus. And before we sign off, before we end our online service today, I want to give you a moment. And if you've never given your life to the Lord, if you've never made that connection, then that's where your journey starts. And so if that's you and you've never given your life to Christ, but you would like to, would you say this prayer with me? I'm just going to lead you real quickly, and wherever you're at, whatever you're doing, just repeat after me. Living God, I give my life to you. Everything I am, I lay at your feet. I receive from you forgiveness for my sins, grace, mercy, love. Lord, let everything you are fill my life. I thank you, Jesus, that you didn't come to diminish me, to diminish my personality, but to brighten me. So I receive you into my life. I thank you for making me a new person. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, if you prayed that prayer for the first time or the first time in a long time, would you write us a comment right now? Whatever watch party you're on, whatever platform you are, would you just send us a comment? If you're on the website and you want to send us an email, we would love to hear from you. And most of all, if you prayed that prayer for the first time, or maybe for the first time in a long time, or maybe you just find yourself saying, listen, I don't really know how to connect with Jesus. I don't know what that looks like. This is what I wanted you to do. Go to our website, www.c3victory.com. When you get on the website, what you're going to see is this tab that says, I made a decision to follow Jesus. Click on that tab, and it's going to help you start a course and to explain all the different parts of building a healthy, dynamic, vibrant, awesome life with Christ. And so we want to walk with you. We want to journey with you as you grow, as you learn to know this incredible Lord that we follow. God bless you. Thank you for watching. Thank you for tuning in. And we'll see you next Sunday.
Hey guys, it's time for us to get ready to give. And I wanted to read again from the book of Acts, chapter 2. We talked a little bit in communion today about it, but I thought it applied so beautifully as well to the message of giving. So let's go to Acts chapter 2, verse 43. And it says this about the early church, that everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. What an interesting thought. Why would they give away or sell what they had to help those in need? You know, during this time, I think we can see so many parallels. We can be so creative right now with how we help those in our community who are in need. Let me share a couple of examples of how the church has been doing this lately. This past week, we partnered together with Vela Farms on the square. And if you don't know Vela Farms, it's a locally owned restaurant. She makes all of her own spices, condiments, jellies, and grew that into a thriving family restaurant. And, you know, Sarah Vela, the owner, has been very vocal in the community, saying that she supports local businesses and wants the best for them. And we agree with that thought. So as the church this week, we got behind Vela Farms and Sarah Vela and that message of supporting local business. And we took $2,000 from the missions fund that you helped give into. And we blessed all the people who live in the Crossroads apartments with hot, fresh plates of food. Isn't that awesome that we got to be a part of not only helping local business, but blessing local families? And the people that went out to give that day, they represented men, women, children, grandfathers, grandmothers from this church. It was just such a beautiful picture of how when we all come together to give what we have, what can be accomplished. I want to share another way you can give right now in Victoria. You know, a lot of us have been doing home renovations, going through our homes, nesting in a sense. Even if you're not pregnant, you've been nesting and cleaning stuff out. And sometimes we don't know what to do with that. And we're thinking, where can we drop it off? On the side of the road or put it out on Facebook? Well, guess what? You can take all your valuable items, not your junk, but all your valuable home goods to the Restore Outlet. That's the Restore Outlet right by Grandy's on North Navarro Street. This is where Habitat for Humanity gathers together items to resell. And this is what is really mainly funding Habitat for Humanity right now. So check this out. You clean out your house, you give away things you don't need, and you're helping another family in need later on build their own home. What a cool, creative way to take what you have and to sow into the lives of someone else. So I just want to remind you right now, listen to what God is saying. Listen to his word. You know, he's very clear on how he instructs us to give and to keep on giving, whether you feel like you have it to give or you don't. God is faithful to his word. There's a couple of ways you can give. You can go to our website, go to the Give tab. It's super easy just to say, click here, takes you to a landing page, drop-down menu of what fund you want to give into. Also, our text to give is always the easiest way to give. You text the word GIVE to 571-7441, set up your text to give app, and you can do that from then on, really easy. And if you'd prefer, you can also send a check-in to the church. We just want to thank you again, church. Thank you for being faithful givers. And I just prophesy over you today that the later part of this year is going to be more blessed than anything you have ever seen before. As you continue to press through, those who are living through slim times financially, but listening to the Lord to be a faithful giver, I just prophesy blessing upon blessing upon blessing over you in Jesus' name.
Hey guys, thanks for having church with us this morning. We'd like to ask you to go to our website at c3victory.com and get to know us a little better. Let us know if you made the decision to follow Jesus today by clicking on that button on our homepage. This time last year, we joined a Following Jesus group and then we decided to get baptized as a married couple.
So we hope that y'all have a great week. We love y'all. We miss y'all. We hope that y'all stay safe and we'll see y'all soon.